I would like
deserve it. It's springtime, so if you need that shed, look them up. Most of all, thank God for being wind in my life. I would first like to start with an explanation of the emblem that you see with the fire in the middle with the EM. My nephew Kyle, who's a football player, and my brother Chris, who's a coach, wanted to spread further awareness of erythromelalgia. So, the St. Thomas Aquinas football team out of Dover, New Hampshire, hosted an awareness day for erythromelalgia at their first home game. My sister Lisa spoke, and everybody was handed information on erythromelalgia. The football team would have them on their football helmets the entire season, spreading more awareness for erythromelalgia. Because of their compassion to help those that they never met, we decided to use that emblem from this day forward on every fundraising event that we have for awareness of them. State Representative Diana DeSoglio already gave you an explanation of what erythromelalgia is, and others after me will get in more depth of it. So I'm just going to jump to the two categories of erythromelalgia. You have primary and you have secondary. If you have primary erythromelalgia, you have a mutated gene, a genetic gene. If you have secondary erythromelalgia, it means that you have a condition that has caused your EM. If they can treat that condition, then your EM symptoms may lessen or go away. If they do not know why you have erythromelalgia, you put back into the first category, primary, and what I call no clue why it happened. Many things set off a flare. Obviously, heat of any source, warm or hot. Spices, certain foods, alcohol, stress, insomnia, wearing socks and shoes, light pressure, light exercise. Just to tell you a little background information about myself, I was a very active individual working full-time as a paralegal, raising two children with my husband, attending sports every night, working out in the gym, and enjoying a very full social life. I began to become sick in 2002 with a lot of medical difficulties. I worked sick for many years, eventually working at home, reducing hours, and then unable to work at all. About almost 4 years ago, I started with just red and hot-to-touch hands. Not painful, not burning yet. Then I would see my toes would become red when I got out of the shower or I removed my shoes. Still not painful, not burning. In 2015, I took a flight to Florida, and when I landed, I had huge bruises all over both my legs. As soon as I stepped outside, the Florida weather was hotter than here, my veins in my arm expanded very, very large, and my hands became red, burning, painful. I spent my entire vacation with ice in them. I believe that the flight made my EM worse. And there are pictures on the table of what I look like anyways when I enter into a hot area, what my veins do. As the year went on, my life changed drastically. I could no longer take showers as the warm water touching my hands or my feet would send me into hours of a burning glare. I started to sit in a chair, put my feet up on the shower wall, and that's how I shower. Now I could no longer step outside if the degree was only 65. Anytime I stepped outside, even if just going to the mailbox, it would start an immediate flare, bulge, veins, red, hot, burning. Going from just a few degrees from room to room affects things. I feel short of breath as if the air is stale. Red flushing would happen on my arms, sometimes my stomach, sometimes my legs. The pictures of the flushing that occurs to me is also on the table. I flirt with everything, cooking, showering, shooting, eating, standing, slight exercise, any slight pressure against my feet, just moving my hands to look through my purse. I could not wear pants or long sleeves, and I kept myself as cool as I could. My EM became so severe, the 24/7 flare never stopped. My daily setup was me elevating my feet above heart level and having a fan below me blowing directly on me. Even in the wintertime, shivering, I needed that fan on me. My house had to be set at 63 degrees. At my window down in the wintertime. Everyone knew it was me when they saw someone driving around with the window down. When you have major life changes like this, especially with no knowledge of what you have, you start to wonder. You think you have blood pooling in your hands, pooling in your feet. Is it my heart not pumping right? Am I going to have a stroke? I just don't know what my life is going to become. What will happen? Life became very frightening and very dark. I literally begged doctors for help and was turned away. I had never begged for anything in my entire life. That's how desperate I was. I stumbled upon the Erythromelalgia Association webpage and immediately knew that I had EM. I printed out the information, took it to my PCP, who verified, yes, you do have EM. He was going to set me up with the Mayo Clinic, but abruptly left his practice, and my Mayo Clinic referral was left in limbo. It took me 4 months to find a primary care who didn't refuse me because I have a rare condition. I finally found a wonderful primary care, Dr. Maureen Norman, who was not afraid to take me on just because of my rare condition. I have been on the Mayo waiting list for 1 year, 8 months. Can you imagine?
The awareness from all around the world. So, including Massachusetts
don't have enough funds, time, or enough doctors interested in further research to discover the other reasons why we have VM or successful ways to treat it. We need medication or treatment specifically for VM. There is a common denominator between all of us. We need to find out what that common denominator is. Medication. There is no one medication to treat VM. It is all trial and error. What helps one person does not necessarily help the next. Sometimes there is no medication that will help you at all. I have tried many medications, all that have not helped me as of this date. I have side effects from it, or it makes my EM worse. Insurance issues. Because EM is rare, the FDA has not approved any medication for it, which means if EM is not on the label, then you may not have coverage for it. Some of the medications that have problems with coverage is lidocaine infusions, lidocaine cream, compounded cream, genetic testing, Botox injections, Lyrica, experimental drugs, and certain seizure medications. The lack of treating doctors. Well, we all know there's a lack of treating doctors because it's a rare disease. But we do need more awareness with hospitals, doctors, and nurses so that they are at least aware of what the symptoms are of erythromelalgia. Emotional side. I want you to imagine this. Imagine that you can no longer take that hot shower at the end of the day. Imagine if you could not be in your own backyard over the degree of 65, spring, summer, fall. Imagine losing your career, missing cookouts, graduation, parties, not being able to sit under a tree and read a good book. Imagine. No outside sports, no beach, no bike rides, no walks on a nice summer night, no hiking, no boating, no fishing. Imagine being on fire all the time. Imagine not being able to hold your grandchild because the heat of her body will set your flare up, will worsen it. Loss of support from family and friends left to feel abandoned. Not being able to go to functions in the wintertime because of the heat. You're trapped, summer and winter. Imagine your life changing this much and having no help and no hope. Imagine literally living on the inside, looking out the window at everyone else, enjoying the simplest things in life. As a parent, you do everything in your power to keep your child safe and healthy. When they have a boo-boo or when they're sick, you pick them up, you comfort them, they feel better. Not with the EM. Infants are being born with EM. Toddlers have it. School-aged children have it. It does not discriminate in age. It is not fair that these little ones have to feel that they are burning alive. Some parents have gone years not knowing what their child has, traveling from doctor to doctor, being disappointed. And then, if they finally find out what they have, it could be years of trial and medication not working. I spoke with some parents who told me their three-year-old child cries owie when he starts to flare. And he does not want to put his socks and shoes out to go play outside. A seven-year-old screams all night long for ice packs. Imagine. A girl at eight started calling it the fire monster. Perfect name. A 17-year-old told me that the worst part was missing school and that it was so debilitating. My heart breaks. I know that everyone here, your heart breaks. I'm going to talk to you lastly and briefly about a protocol that I've tried. Through an online EM support group on Facebook, I read about a man named Bob Bartholomew who tried soaking his feet in warm water and then increased it slowly as time went by. Bob also turned the heat up in his house. And he started going on daily walks wearing We will be releasing a video in June of testimonies of those who have tried Rod's protocol. I started doing it. I was hesitant for 3 to 4 months, scared to put my feet in the slightest of warm water. But I couldn't deny the positive feedback that I read online. And so I told myself, you gotta do this, you gotta try it, no matter what, no matter how painful it will be. You have to cross off everything and try everything. So I did. I started with warm water. I started with more December. I am now up to hot, hot water, as hot as I can possibly get it. 20 minutes a day, followed by a 10-minute hot, steaming shower. I still flare. I still have burning pain, but I'm not going to flare 24/7 anymore. So the positive changes that it has brought me is I sit on a recliner like a normal person, no more elevating of a hot level. I shower rather than sit. I wear flip-flops rather than being barefoot. I do not use any cooling products anymore. My temperature in my house can now be on 66 rather than 63. We need research. We need a cure. We're burning alive, and it's time to put the fire out. Thank you, everyone, for listening to my story.
Good news. school has us in the air conditioners and all the floors are carpeted.
That must be pretty tough, Sebastian, to be homeschooled. Are your friends supportive?
Yeah.
It's really cool. That's important. Can you tell us what the most difficult part of your journey with Ian is?
Not being able to hang out with friends and family as much as they want to.
Because you can't go places in the wintertime with the heat and the summertime with the heat. When you found out that you had small fiber neuropathy, how did that make you feel?
It made me feel happy and sad at the same time. Happy to know what I have and sad to know that I'm going to be living with pain.
I can definitely relate to that. So,
the founding of the Erythromelalgia Association. nearly 20 years ago. TEA is the only nonprofit in the world solely dedicated to providing education, awareness, and support regarding EN and to funding research into EN. And we are an all-volunteer run, meaning we can devote every dollar we raise and receive back to this mission. Because we're run by volunteers, all of whom have EN, we especially like those of Paula and Corey to organize events like this. Thank you, Paula. The Erythromelalgia Association works in a number of ways. For people with erythromelalgia and their family and caretakers, the Erythromelalgia Association provides access to information on how to identify and manage their EN. Information to share with their doctors. I can't tell you how many times I've heard from erythromelalgia patients and their doctors and know what they were dealing with, that did not know what they were dealing with until the patient brought one of our brochures to an appointment. We have developed a patient guide, and brochures and patient guides are over here on this table for you to take with you today. And I ask you to please take them with you today so I don't have to carry them back to Philadelphia. TEA compiles all the latest research into erythromelalgia in one place, allowing anyone to access it online at any time for free. The Erythromelalgia Association works to bring patients together, to share stories and support with each other, and we maintain the only database of patient recommended doctors familiar with erythromelalgia. And the Erythromelalgia Association funds research into erythromelalgia and its treatment. To date, thanks to our generous donors, the Erythromelalgia Association has granted tens of thousands of dollars to erythromelalgia research at Yale. Research that led to the discovery of the role the NaV1.7 sodium channel has in the transmission of pain. This finding motivated several pharmaceutical companies to move ahead with work on the development of drugs to block that channel. I will be blunt. EN is hard. It is painful and limiting and has no cure. But the Erythromelalgia Association is working to lift that burden from people with erythromelalgia to the extent we can through support and community. And we believe that there can be better care for people with erythromelalgia, better education and medical professionals, better diagnosis and better treatment. And one day I am confident that there will be a cure. We will continue to work every day to make this a reality. Thank you. And now I would like to introduce Beth for Jonathan's. I'm sorry if I mentioned her. She also is living with erythromelalgia. That NaV1.7 acts as a volume knob on pain signaling neurons. Education as a model disorder that teaches more about many forms of human pain. EM is an even more important disease target. Against this background, Ms. Corey's call for increased attention to EM is even more compelling. Research by my team at Yale University, 35 scientists strong, and in laboratories around the world, is advancing towards the development of new medications that will alleviate the pain associated with erythromelalgia without side effects such as dizziness, double vision, or confusion, and without the potential for addiction. Progress to date is very encouraging, but research takes time, and more time is needed. It is funding that drives this research, and I applaud the efforts of the EM community and its core to obtain more substantial support for research on EM and related disorders. I am confident that ultimately we will win this war. I look forward to celebrating together with the EM community when we win the battle against EM and related disorders, and I again commend Ms. Corey for her efforts. Sincerely, Stephen G. Waxman, MD, PhD, Yale University School of Medicine. EM doesn't exist. They flew to Toronto where she had family, and they stayed for 9 months until she was finally able to see a doctor right here in Boston. She was able to get a proper diagnosis, but she's the only person in her region right now diagnosed with erythromelalgia. And they're trying to raise awareness back in Dubai, and they started their EM challenge. When I began speaking with Paula about the event today, to approach my gym, Orange 3 because of that way, and they wanted to help me raise awareness while we were trying to get this event together, and they asked me how they could help. And I thought it would be a great idea to bring Lynn's story full circle since she was diagnosed right here in Boston, and I wanted to make the recommend challenge right back here. So my gym actually had all the members write words of encouragement to all the EM sufferers, and they also wrote their names and the towns that they're from. And I think it's a great way just to show the EM community that you do have support right here in Massachusetts. So I encourage all of you just to take a look at that on your way out. They make me cry, so just take a look at me again. Okay, so here we go. My name is Becca Janowitz, and I have erythromelalgia. I was officially diagnosed in November 2017 after 13 years of looking for answers for a myriad of health issues that started shortly after graduating high school. It started with a minor discoloration in my feet, then in my hands, and my blood pressure spiked out of nowhere. I started getting terrible headaches 2 to 3 times a week. Then came severe digestive issues, which caused anxiety whenever I had made plans to go out since I was attending college in Boston at the time. I became extremely sensitive to certain clothing and experienced severe skin reactions, including unexplainable rashes all over my body. Then burning sensations started in my feet and my hands, and it creeped up my legs and my arms. Sometimes my face would even look like I had a sunburn halfway through the day. My primary care physician referred me to specialists for each of these ailments, but every time the testing got negative or inconclusive, each specialist would refer me to someone else, or just dismiss me with cold and empty responses. You're in college. You're under a lot of stress. Maybe you're just not cut out for undergraduate studies right now. Have you considered therapy? This could just all be in your head. You're a woman, and women do tend to be a bit more dramatic than men when it comes to pain. 13 years of being poked and looked over, 13 years of being critiqued with my story straight, even slightly in detail, 13 years of medication from my primary care doctor, attempting to alleviate each individual symptom I was experiencing, most importantly my blood pressure. My heart's been working in overdrive for over 13 years, and I've been told there's a possibility it could be bad with me without warning, all simply because it was in my head. My first thought after the end had to repeat the name a few times? Great. I have a disorder that's harder to pronounce than my last name. Dr. Nover tried to explain the end to me as best he could at the time allotted for my appointment. He explained that given the rest of my symptoms, the best course of action would be to assess whether I had primary or secondary EM, which would require genetic testing and a full autoimmune workup of it. I had an answer after 14 years of being dismissed, misdiagnosed, underdiagnosed. I was on board with whatever he needed. I called the numbers I was given to schedule, everything that he had instructed, and that's when I hit the first roadblock as a newly diagnosed patient. The wait time for the tests I needed was a little overwhelming, to say the least. I'd have to wait over 5 months for my autonomic workup at regular appointments because they only offered on Tuesdays. And apparently there are a lot of other sick people just like me desperate for answers. During that 5 month wait, I turned to the internet to find as much information as I could. What I found was a little disheartening. The disorder was discovered in the 1800s, but little is known about it. There was some research published, but I couldn't find any systematic effort between researchers, doctors, hospitals to really understand EM. I just found separate articles and videos listing definitions, different origins, treatments, and probable life expectancies for patients suffering with EM. I would most likely end up in a wheelchair, be unable to work full time for much longer, and I wouldn't be able to enjoy the outdoors like I used to. It was a scary 5 months for me, and I had no idea what to expect. When I was finally able to have the test done, along with a skin biopsy, I was diagnosed with small fiber neuropathy. Over 40% of my small nerve fibers were damaged or dead. I tested negative for the SCN9A gene, so I have secondary EM. However, aspirin has not been able to fix me. And just because I've been diagnosed with SFN, my EM has not improved. In fact, my flares, my quality of life have both been on the decline in the past 7 months. I'm extremely blessed to finally have a proper diagnosis with quantitative and indisputable data on paper. However, the second leg of my journey has just begun. EM is rare, whether it's primary or secondary. And when you have small fiber neuropathy with other medical conditions, finding the root cause of your SFN can prove to be complicated. Autoimmune testing, paraneoplastic testing have all come back negative. The chief of the Division of Autoimmune Neurology has yet to be able to pinpoint why 40% of my small nerve fibers are damaged and dead. And just like primary EM sufferers, treatment is trial and error. And when you see the chief of the Division of Autonomic Neurology for care of something that's rare, your appointments are between 5 and 6 months apart, and 20 minutes tops, because so many other people are anxiously waiting to see him just like you. I have never met a doctor that has worked as hard as Dr. Novak. I don't know how he manages to work his way up and down the stairwells between the lab and his office at regular appointments. But he does, trying to fit in as many patients as he can in a given day. He knows patients fly from all over the world to see him, and he knows what it means if he doesn't keep a tight schedule all day long. Massachusetts is a mecca for advancements in medicine. We have the most brilliant doctors and specialists here. We are so lucky to be within driving distance from cutting-edge medicine. However, no one ever talks about the fact that you're forced to wait 5 months to a year to see these great minds about your debilitating illness or the damage being done while you wait for your next appointment. Since being diagnosed last November, I've been put on 2 medications on 2 separate occasions in an effort to improve my current condition, and on both the results were severe negative reactions. The most recent has resulted in hair loss, open sores on my body, and involuntary muscle spasms that were more painful than I could put into words. 7 months, 2 drug trials, no progress. And now I know I'm not alone. We need to do better than this. These brilliant minds need support so that their patients don't have to wait 5 to 6 months in between. We, as EM patients, need support from our communities. so that we don't feel so isolated and alone as we navigate through the murky waters of regulatory regimes and stakeholders in the healthcare industry with misaligned incentives like publishing, promotions, and tenure. Imagine what would be accomplished and how many lives would be changed for the better if scientists and researchers recognize that people are at the center of their research and that we could all benefit from collaboration. Imagine how many more patients would be helped if brilliant minds like Dr. Novak had funding and more staff to carry out the work that they're doing now. Patients like me wouldn't have to suffer as much as we do for as long as we do if we had better access to care and opportunities to participate in EM research. The mental and emotional toll that EM takes on you can be even more damaging than the physical pain that's felt every day. When people can't see the suffering with their own eyes, it's hard for them to understand why you can't make girls' night out or your best friend's birthday. And the less they understand, the more distant they become. Until you find yourself no longer being invited out anymore and hearing from your friends. This disorder strips you down to your studs. This is what it's like living with EM, and this needs to change. I may not benefit from the changes that will come from what we were trying to start here today, raising awareness and relaying the need for research funding and support. But great things come from humble beginnings. And if there are breakthroughs for treatment, or even a cure for EM someday, then all this effort will be worth it. Thank you.
So I've tried to prepare a one-page handout that has urine test is perfect. The tests are currently recommended by the American